Hello guys, so I just wanted to do a quick revision of the intercostal nerves, the arteries, and the venous drainage of the thoracic wall quickly, because I don't know if it was only for me or all of you guys, but I had difficulties when it comes to the arterial supply and the venous drainage of the thoracic wall, right? So after today's practical, I don't know, I managed to find a way of summarizing everything. So if hopefully it will help you. If it doesn't, I tried. But maybe if you have simplest ways, you will share with us. So I'll firstly start with the intercostal nerves. Obviously, we all know that the intercostal nerves are between the ribs, right? So we know that they are part of the neurovascular bundle, right? Remember that it is your vein, your artery, and your nerve in that order, starting like from the superior going inferiorly. But we all know our own entity that one, right? So what I want to basically do in this video is just to discuss the cause of the thoracic nerves, right? So before I can even start with the thoracic, with the intercostal nerves, the first thing we must understand what intercostal nerves are, right? And intercostal nerves are basically your spinal nerves, right? They are basically your spinal nerves. Remember that you have your cranial nerves and then you have your spinal nerves, they run pairs, right? So these are your spinal nerves. And then where are they specifically found? Because we know that the spinal nerves, we have the cervical ones, we have the thoracic, the lumbar, and the sacral, then we have one coccygeal, right? So your spinal nerves, these ones, to be specific, the intercostals, obviously they'll be found, these are your thoracic spinal nerves, right? They are your thoracic spinal nerves. So your thoracic spinal nerves, we have 12 of them from T1 to T12, right? T1 to T12. But T12 is not considered an intercostal nerve, right? T12 is considered a subcostal nerve. It's a subcostal nerve. I'll just write subcostal, right? This is a subcostal nerve. And then it means that T1 to T11, those are the ones that are considered intercostal nerves. Sorry for that, guys. These people are making noise. Okay, so I was saying that T1 to T11, those are the ones that are considered to be intercostal nerves. And then T12 is called the subcostal nerve. And then from there, you have to understand that we further divide that the intercostal nerves into. Guys, sorry again. So the intercostal nerves, we have the atypical. The atypical ones, and then we have the typical ones, right? So when we say that they are typical, we expect them to come to the thorax, right? We expect them to come to the thorax. Forgive me for writing funny, right? So what you have to understand with the typical is that the typical, as I just said, we expect them to come to the thorax, right? So since we call them intercostal nerves, as I said, they're between the ribs, right? So these nerves, the typical ones, they supply the muscles and the skin of the intercostal spaces, right? So in your intercostal space, these nerves that are typical intercostal nerves, they supply the muscles that we find in between the ribs, and they supply the skin that is just overlying that particular intercostal space. I hope that makes sense. And the typical intercostal nerves that we have, it's T3 to T6. These are the typical that we have, right? And then going to the atypical ones, obviously, 12 is already included in the atypical ones because we just said that it is not considered part of the intercostals. It's a subcostal, right? So it's just below the ribs, right? The below the last rib. right? So it's not supplying the thorax as we want it to, right? But on top of that, it's not the only one. We'll come back to it. I'll start with T1, right? T1 and T2, right? T1 and T2. So what is the difference, or what makes T1 and T2 not to be typical intercostal nerves? They are intercostal nerves, but they are not the typical ones because they're not coming to supply the thoracic wall. So the T1, we say that it's atypical because it's involved in the brachial plexus. And we know that the brachial plexus are going, they supply mainly the upper limb, right? So T1 is involved in the brachial plexus, right? We haven't done the upper limb yet, but what constitutes the brachial plexus is C5, C6, C7, C8, and T1, right? So T1 is involved in the brachial plexus. So hence it's considered the atypical ones, the atypical one, right? So going to T2, it's sending a branch, right, to the medial aspect of the arm, right? It's sending a branch to the medial aspect of the arm, and that branch will be called what? The intercostal brachial nerve. I'll just write intercostal brachial nerve, right? So this will be going to the arm. So since it's going to the arm, we won't consider it as a typical one, right? So this T1 and T2, they are both involved in like supplying the upper limb, right? So from there, what is left is T7 to T12. So T7 to T12, they're also considered the atypical ones, right? I'm sorry, guys, for that pain. Bad handwriting. It's T7 to T12, right? Because they're called, T7 to T12, they're also called the thoracolumbar intercostal nerves, right? Because it's like they are supplying partly the thorax and they are going to the lumbar region as well, right? So the most important thing is that they are considered atypical ones, right? So the only typical ones is T3 to T6. And then when we're discussing that, and then I'll just take, because the course, right, the course of the intercostal nerves is the same. So I'll just do one example, starting from the vertebrae, because that's what they did on our slides, right? So let's assume this is your vertebrae, right? We just cut it, we do a coronal section, we get, this is your vertebrae, and then you know that in your vertebrae, you have the dorsal root and then you have the ventral root, right? So from the dorsal root, which is mainly sensory, you will have nerve coming like that, and then from the ventral root, which is mainly motor, and then they will join, right? The dorsal root and the ventral root will join to form the trunk, right? And then from the trunk, that is where you will get your spinal nerves, right? You will get the dorsal ramus and the ventral ramus, right? So the intercostal nerves come from the ventral ramus, right? So what will happen is that the ventral ramus will come and then it will come around the ribs, in between the ribs, of course. And then when it gets to the level of the sternum, it will descend, it will go straight downwards, right? So let's assume at this level, you have your sternum. So when it gets to that level, just lateral to the sternum, it will go downwards. So at this level, when it starts going downwards, we call it the anterior cutaneous nerve, right? Here we call it the anterior cutaneous nerve. And then in its way, coming here, it will give off branches, right? It will first give a branch going to the lateral, going laterally, we call it the lateral cutaneous nerve, right? So the one that is coming to the anterior part, we call it the anterior cutaneous nerve, but it will give a branch before going there, which is going laterally, we call it the lateral cutaneous nerve. And the lateral cutaneous nerve, we further divide into two, we divide into the posterior and the anterior lateral cutaneous nerve, right? That is pretty simple. But before you can even go there, in between here, the nerve, we said that it runs between the ribs, right? But we know that between the ribs, we find three muscles. We find the external muscles, the external intercostal and the internal intercostal and the innermost, right, muscles. So this nerve, let me just say the neurovascular pulse, the intercostal vein, the artery and the nerve, they run between the innermost and the intercostal, right? So let's assume this is your innermost muscle and this is your intercostal muscle. So the nerve will be in between. And then in between those muscles, it will give branches, right? What are those branches? The branches are going to supply the muscles. So we call them muscular branches, right? We call them muscular branches. I'll just write muscular. And then from there, it will also give another, and then obviously, okay, you know that from here you will have your rib, but I won't draw it, and your external intercostal muscles. The most important ones is the innermost and the intercostal, because it runs just between those two, right? And then it will also give another branch here, which is called the collateral branch, right? This is called the collateral branch. So that is the nerve, that is the intercostal nerve, the typical intercostal nerve, that is the root. It starts at the vertebrae, the dorsal root and the ventral root, they form the trunk, and then you have the dorsal ramus and the ventral ramus. From the ventral ramus, it will continue, and then it will give a branch called the lateral cutaneous nerve. And then when it gets to the anterior part, we call it the anterior cutaneous nerve, and then it will give these three branches, the lateral cutaneous, the muscular, and the collateral branch, right? And then you know that if we go from the vertebrae descending down, like going downwards from the vertebral column, we have what we call the sympathetic trunk and ganglion, right? It's simply something like a chain, something like this, right? So what will happen is we will get another branch, right? Another branch from the ventral ramus, right? We'll get another branch from the ventral ramus going to the ganglion, right? So you know that for in each and every ganglion, we have the presynaptic and the postsynaptic fibers. So it will go to the ganglion, right? To the sympathetic ganglion, right? And then it will synapse with another, let me use a different color. It will synapse with the postsynaptic fiber, which will go back to the ventral ramus. So this green one, the presynaptic fiber, we call it the white ramus, right? It's called the white ramus, right? It's white ramus. And then the postsynaptic one, we call it the gray ramus. So this is the white, this is the gray ramus. So it will go back, right? So that is all that we have to know about the intercostal nerve. That is all that happens in each and every intercostal nerve, right? And then with T7 to T12, because I said this is what the typical ones, this is the course of the typical ones, which is T3 to T6. And then with your T7 to T12, they supply the intercostal spaces and the abdominal wall, because I told you that they are also called the thoracolumbar, right? So they don't supply, they are not only restricted to supply the subcostal spaces that they are found in, right? They supply the intercostal spaces, not the subcostal, sorry. They supply the intercostal spaces that they are found in, and then they even supply what? The abdominal wall, right? So that is only T7 to T12. And then the typical ones only supply the intercostal spaces in which they are found, right? So what happens is that with this one, the easiest way to remember this one, is that you take the umbilicus, right? You go to the umbilicus, right? So the umbilicus is at the level of T10 approximately. So from T10 to, you have T7 right there. So this part of the abdominal wall is supplied by T7 from T7 to T10. And then the lower part is until T12, right? So that is just, that is all that you have to know for about the typical ones, right? Just know that T10 is at the level of the umbilicus. And then from there up until T7, that is the thoracolumbar nerves supplying that area. And then from T10 until T12, thoracolumbar. But remember that your T12 is it has a different name called the subcostal. The most important thing is this one, understanding the course of the intercostal nerve, which is a typical one, not just a typical one, right? So that is it. That is all that we have to know about the intercostal nerves. Know that we have the typical and the atypical, and which ones are atypical, which ones are atypical, and why they are called atypical, right? So we will go to the intercostal arteries. So for your intercostal arteries, it's not that different, but it is different, but it's easier for you to understand if you understood the intercostal nerves. So I will also do the course of this one, right? But the first thing that you have to understand, if I can even start with the intercostal arteries, I want you to understand that anteriorly, I just said it, that the intercostal spaces are spaces between ribs, right? So anteriorly, we have 9 intercostal spaces, right? So it would mean that we will have 9 arteries anteriorly. I repeat, anteriorly, we have 9 intercostal spaces, right? And then posteriorly, we have 11 intercostal spaces. So it would mean posteriorly we will have how many intercostal arteries? 11. And then anteriorly we will have 9, right? So that is what I wanted to clarify before I can even start, right? So I'll start with the orientation. Let's assume that here you have your vertebrae. So I'll just write V. This is your vertebrae. And then anteriorly you have your, let's say somewhere there, this is your sternum, right? This is your sternum. So you have the vertebrae and then you have the sternum here. And then what we have posteriorly, close to the vertebrae, we all know that you have what? The descending aorta. So this is the descending aorta, just write DE, right? This is descending aorta. And then anteriorly, closer to the sternum, you have what we call the internal thoracic artery. The internal thoracic artery, I didn't see it in the specimen that we had today, but it's the most anterior one. You will never miss it. The internal thoracic artery. Internal thoracic artery. So posteriorly, closer to the vertebrae, we have the descending aorta. Anteriorly, just close to the sternum, right? Mostly it is close to the sternum, but not that close, but you'll never miss it. It's the internal thoracic artery, right? So there are branches. This is where we'll get the intercostal arteries. If they ask you what's the source of the intercostal arteries anteriorly, the source will be what? The internal thoracic artery. Posteriorly, what's the source? Is the descending aorta. Right, so what will happen is that from the descending aorta you will get a branch which is called the posterior intercostal artery. From there you will get a branch. The name of this branch is what? Posterior intercostal artery. Sorry for the bad handwriting. Posterior intercostal artery. So the posterior intercostal artery will give It's hence I said that if you understood the intercostal nerve, it will be easier for you to understand this one, because it also gives a branch, the collateral branch, right? Because remember that at that side we had a collateral branch part of the nerve. This side we have a collateral branch part of the artery, right? So you have you have your posterior intercostal artery, and then you have your collateral branch. And then from the internal thoracic artery, you have the superior and the inferior intercostal arteries, right? But since they are since this is anterior, they say it's superior and inferior anterior intercostal artery. So this would be the superior anterior intercostal artery, and this would be the inferior anterior intercostal artery. So the superior anterior intercostal artery will anastomose with the posterior intercostal artery, and the inferior anterior intercostal artery will anastomose with the collateral branch of the posterior intercostal artery. I don't know if that makes sense. So this is the superior, this is the inferior. Where is the superior and inferior anterior intercostal arteries coming from? They come from the internal thoracic artery. And where is the collateral branch coming from? It's a branch of what? Of the posterior intercostal artery. So this will anastomose, the collateral branch will anastomose with the inferior anterior intercostal artery, and the superior anterior intercostal artery will anastomose with the main branch of the posterior intercostal artery, right? I hope that makes sense and I'm not confusing you at all, guys. And then while we are still on that, what you have to understand now, the question is, where does the, because we know that the posterior intercostal artery comes from the descending aorta, where does the internal thoracic artery come from, right? The internal thoracic artery comes from the subclavian vein. So I don't want to confuse you. Let me throw it here. If this is your, the same internal thoracic artery, this one, it is a branch of what? The branch of the subclavian artery. Remember that the subclavian artery has three parts, if I'm not mistaken. So it comes from the first part, but that is not important. Just know that it is a branch of the subclavian artery, right? It's a branch of the subclavian artery. And then what it will do, it will descend, and in each intercostal space, it will give the superior and inferior branch. In each intercostal space, remember we have 9 intercostal spaces anterior. So it means that it will give in each intercostal space number 1, it will give superior and inferior. Intercostal space number 2, it will give superior and inferior anterior intercostal arteries in each and every intercostal space as it's going down. But when it gets to the 6th, right? When it gets to the 6th intercostal space, it will divide into 2, right? It will bifurcate, right? When it gets to the 6th intercostal space, it will bifurcate. So it will divide into 2. Dividing into 2, forming what? Forming the musculophrenic artery and the superior epigastric artery, right? The musculophrenic artery and the what? The superior epigastric artery, right? The musculophrenic, remember that we said that it bifurcated the 6th intercostal space. So how many spaces are we left with? 3 more to get to 9. So the 7th, 8th, and 9th, 7th to 9th intercostal spaces will be supplied by what? By the musculophrenic artery, not by the by the branches from the internal thoracic artery itself. I repeat, the spaces from 7 to 9 will be supplied by the musculophrenic artery. But spaces 1 to 6 are supplied by the internal thoracic artery, right? And then this superior epigastric artery will anastomose with the inferior epigastric artery. So what will happen is that you will have the inferior epigastric artery coming like that. Where's the inferior epigastric artery coming from? It's coming from the external iliac artery. That is not important for now, but what you have to know is that they will anastomose also at the level of the umbilicus, which we said is T10, right? They will anastomose at the level of the umbilicus inside the rectus sheath, the sheath that is covering your rectus muscles, right? So they will anastomose there. But I don't think they'll ask us this one, right? because it's not in the thorax, but this one, the superior epigastric artery, you have to, right? You have to know because it's a branch of the internal thoracic artery, right? So that is what I want you to know. And then now we have to go to the posterior, because I told you, I don't think there's something that I'm forgetting on the anterior part. Just understand that the first to sixth intercostal spaces are supplied by the internal thoracic artery, and 7 to 9 are supplied by the musculophrenic artery, right? That is all that we have to know. Now, this what we were doing here, we were dealing with the anterior intercostal arteries, right? We're dealing with the anterior intercostal arteries. Now I want us to deal with the posterior intercostal arteries, right? The posterior intercostal arteries, they are not that different from, okay, let me actually do them here. These are the anterior intercostal arteries. Let me do this. These are the posterior intercostal arteries here, the posterior intercostal arteries. So with your posterior intercostal arteries, it's different. Remember that anteriorly you have the main source is the internal thoracic artery. And then I said the posteriorly the main source is what? Is the descending aorta, right? But what's tricky here is that the posterior intercostal artery, it starts giving branches, it will start supplying the third intercostal artery. That intercostal space, right, going to the last one, which is 12, right? This one doesn't have, it doesn't branch into two, like the anterior, right? So it will only supply the third to the 12th, which, what is that, the posterior intercostal arteries. So the question is, what supplies the first and the second intercostal spaces, right? So what supplies the first and the second intercostal spaces is what we call the superior intercostal artery. Right, so you have the subclavian vein. Again, from the subclavian vein, you have another branch, right, which we call the superior intercostal artery. This superior intercostal artery, from it, you will have branches that will be supplying the first and second, right? But posteriorly, guys, don't confuse this. Posteriorly, this is only for the posterior. Anteriorly, everything is supplied by the internal thoracic artery, right? This is for the posterior. This superior intercostal artery is only for the posterior intercostal arteries, right? Not intercostal arteries. For supplying the posterior part, right? Whereas this one is supplying the anterior part of the ribs. I hope that makes sense, right? So the main thing that we have to understand here is that the anterior part, the main source is the internal thoracic, and the posterior part, the main source is the dorsal descending aorta. But that descending aorta, from it, you get the posterior intercostal artery, which only starts supplying the third intercostal space going to the 12th one, right? So the first and the second are supplied by what? By the superior intercostal artery, which is a branch of the subclavian artery. I hope that makes sense and I'm not confusing you at all, right? And we also have a branch of the axillary artery, but I won't discuss that one because I didn't see it in the slides, right? So I won't touch on that one. So I hope that makes sense. So now I want to go to the venous drainage and then we are done. So this is your venous drainage of the thoracic wall, right? So the first thing that I want to start with is that the posterior intercostal veins, right? The anterior ones is not a problem. Anteriorly, it's not a problem. Let me even start with the anterior before it can even confuse you. Remember, okay, let's say this is the sternum again, right? So remember that in the sternum, close to the sternum, what do you have? You have the internal thoracic, and then the internal thoracic artery. And then when it gets to the sixth intercostal space, it will divide into two, forming the musculophrenic and the superior epigastric, right? And then what accompanies it, right, right along with it, it's the veins, right? we have the veins coming like that, and then they will meet at the level of the third intercostal space. So they meet right around the, about the level of the third intercostal space. So what are the name of these veins? They are called the vena comitans, right? They are called the vena comitans. So they will meet at the third space, and then what do we do from them? From the internal thoracic vein, right? So the internal thoracic vein will go, where does it branch from? Branches from the brachiocephalic vein. So this is the brachiocephalic vein. So it means from the brachiocephalic vein, we get the what? The internal thoracic vein, which will divide into two, about the third intercostal space, forming the vena comitans, right? So that is it. That is the venous drainage of the anterior part of the thoracic wall, right? The what is complicated, not really complicated as such, but what is what we have to do deal with is the posterior, right? Hey, sorry for that, because someone called me. I don't even know what I was saying. But that is what you have to understand. The brachiocephalic vein gives the internal thoracic vein, which divides the third intercostal third intercostal space to give the vena comitans, right? So that is the anterior. It's very simple. But the, what you have to understand is that the vena comitans, they will drain the anterior intercostal veins, right? So the vena comitans will drain the anterior intercostal veins. That's it. And then for the posterior intercostal veins, they drain through what we call the isogous system. That is what is a bit complicated, right? So the posterior intercostal veins, they use the isogous system as their drainage, right? So what happens is that for your isogous system, you have the right side and the left side, right? So the right side, you get in your right side, you get your isogous vein, right? Just right, easy, right? You get your isogous vein. And then in your left side, you get your two hemiazygos, right? So in the left side, you get two hemiazygos, right? So you have the two hemiazygos. The first one is the inferior. The first one is the inferior hemiazygos, and the other one is the superior hemiazygos. But the superior hemiazygos is also called the accessory hemiazygos, right? So you get your two hemiazygos, the inferior and the superior, but the superior is also called the accessory hemiazygos, right? So let me just try to draw a simplified diagram to show you this system. So let's assume this is your vertebrae, and then in your vertebrae, you have the, let's say, the right hand side, right? On your right side, you have the inferior vena cava here. This is the inferior vena cava. And then somewhere there, you have the superior vena cava. So what connects these two, right? What connects these two is the azygos vein. So the azygos vein runs from this inferior vena cava. And then let me do this before I mislead you. Let me just start here, right? We have the, you know that the, just in front of the vertebrae in the diaphragm, right? You have the opening, they're called the aortic hiatus, right? So let's assume this is the aortic hiatus, the opening of the descending aorta, right? This azygos vein will pass there. It will pass through that opening. And then where will it go? It will go to the superior vena cava, right? It will go to the superior vena cava. So what will happen is that the posterior intercostal arteries, or before I can even go there, what forms the superior vena cava is what? The two brachiocephalic veins, right? The left brachiocephalic vein and the right brachiocephalic vein, right? So the first intercostal space will drain into the right brachiocephalic vein. I repeat, the first intercostal space will drain into the right brachiocephalic vein. And then the second and the third will drain into the superior intercostal vein, right? Superior intercostal vein, which will go to the arc of the azygos vein. I repeat, this, what I'm throwing in black is the superior intercostal vein, right? It will drain what? The second and the third. Will drain the second and the third. So the second and third drain into the superior intercostal vein, which will go to the arc of the what? Of the azygos vein. And then as for the fourth until the 11th, fourth to 11th, fourth to 11th one, they will drain into the azygos vein. So they will drain into this azygos vein. And then what about the 12th one, which is called the subcostal, right? Remember we said the 12th is called the subcostal. So it will also drain into the azygos vein, but the lower part of it, right? So this is the 12th. So that is what you have to understand from the right hand side. That the first one goes directly to the right brachiocephalic. The second and the third, they drain into the superior intercostal vein, which goes to the arc of the azygos vein. And then the fourth to the 12th, they go to the azygos vein straight, right? And then since we spoke about the aortic hiatus, what else passes there? What else passes through the aortic hiatus? We have the thoracic duct, what I'm drawing here. And then obviously you have the main structure that is passing there, which is the aorta, the descending aorta, right? So those are the structures, the descending aorta, the azygos vein and the thoracic duct. Those are the structures that pass through the aortic hiatus, right? And then that is it from the right-hand side. That is the azygos vein. So now let's go to the left-hand side, because we said on the left-hand side we have two hemiazygos. We said we have the superior and the inferior hemiazygos, right? So I'll start it from the bottom, right? Because it's easier to understand when you start it from the bottom. So we have what we call the ascending lumbar, and then we have the subcostal vein, the ascending lumbar vein and the subcostal vein. So the ascend, this is the subcostal, and then we have the ascending lumbar vein. They will join to form the inferior hemiazygos. So this is the inferior, just right, AMF, inferior hemiazygos vein, right? So the inferior hemiazygos vein will ascend, and then it will go to join the azygos vein, right? And then what will drain into the inferior hemiazygos, it's your 8th to 11th, right? 8th to 11th will drain into the inferior hemiazygos, because 12 is this one, it's the subcostal vein, right? So this is the inferior. So the superior hemiazygos vein will only drain the what? The fourth. Only drain the fourth. Right? I repeat, it will only drain the fourth. Some textbooks say that 8th is part of this one. Some say 8th is part of this one. Check the slides. Check the slides. Right? And then for your second and third, it's the same as what is happening on the right-hand side. So your second and third, will drain into the superior intercostal vein, superior intercostal vein, which will go to the left brachiocephalic vein. And then just like the first intercostal space was draining into the brachiocephalic vein, also the first one on this side will go to the brachiocephalic vein. So this simplifies everything. When it's like this, it's simplified. It's very, very simplified. And when you're looking at the cadaver, when you see the ones that do on your left-hand side, the only two ones that are going double, it's either the superior hemizygous or the inferior, right? It's easy. And then just know that the first brings directly into the precursor phallic vein, and then the second and the third, they go to the superior intercostal vein, which will go to the precursor phallic vein, right? And then I feel like the right-hand side is more easier compared to the left. And then on the left, just understand that the superior hemiazygos or the accessory hemiazygos only drains the fourth intercostal space, right? So that is it. That is it. That is what we have to understand. And then another thing, I don't know why there are variations, but the azygous system can also start in, like it can start in the inferior vena cava, just like I showed you here, starting with the azygous vein, or it can start with the subcostal and the ascending lumbar, just like on the left-hand side, or it can start by coming from the renal vein, right? But we won't do that one of the renal vein. For now, just know this one, right? So that is what is important. And then I think that's about it, because I wanted to show you the course of the nerves, the course of the arteries, and the course of the veins. So if you have an easier way you can share with us, please let me know in the comment section below if you did understand, if you did enjoy the video, if you have any questions. That is it from me, guys. Thank you.